Good morning and welcome to a very strange St. Peter's service, it feels. I'm standing here in my office with one member of my congregation, which is my dad, and we're going to have a service this morning. Things have got very different in this world over these last few weeks and months and coming up to a year. We're locked down in the United Kingdom. But what I can say is that God is not locked down. God is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. God is always there. And it's to that God that we're going to pray now. So let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, as we come to our service this morning, we pray that you will speak to each one of us, wherever we are this morning, however we're feeling. Father, we ask that you will send your Holy Spirit upon each and every one of us. Speak into our hearts and our minds. Father, if we're feeling dark, we pray that you will shed your light upon us. If we're feeling sad, we pray that you will restore joy into our lives once again. Amen.
Amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
And also with you. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Give us the joy of your saving help.
And sustain us with your life-giving spirit.
We've come together in the name of Christ to offer our prayers and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we may give ourselves to the service of God. Jesus says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand. So let us turn away from our sin and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. And I don't know whether any of you have the order of service this morning, but the words that you say are the ones that are in bold. The other ones are the ones that I'll say for you. So let's say together, Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. And may the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Blessed is the Lord, for he has heard the voice of our prayer. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy, and in our song we will praise our God. Blessed are you, Lord our God, creator and redeemer of all. To you be glory and praise forever. From the waters of chaos, you drew forth the world, and in your great love, fashioned us in your image. Now, through the deep waters of death, you have brought us, your people, to new birth, by raising your Son to life in triumph. May Christ, your light, ever dawn in our hearts as we offer you our sacrifice of thanks and praise. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God forever. The night has passed, and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may your light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Today, the scripture that is set for this morning is Mark chapter 1, verses 4 to 11. And so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. John wore clothing made of camel hair with a leather belt around his waist. And he ate locusts and wild honey. And this was his message. After me comes the one more powerful than I, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven. You are my son, whom I love. With you, I am well pleased. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we look at this passage, it's a passage that we know so well quite often. So Father, help us to see these words with that joy of seeing it for the first time. Father, send your Spirit now upon each one of us, wherever we are. In your name, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
So we begin with John the Baptist, Elizabeth's son and Jesus' cousin. Now, I know we don't really hear much about him until after his birth until now, but it's not like he's just got up one morning and thought, "Ooh, do you know what, today I'm going to go out and I'm going to do a bit of Messiah prophesying. I'll get that hair shirt out of the cupboard and I'll shove a few locusts in my pocket and off I go." This wasn't something that John just decided to do. It wasn't something that he made up. It was foretold hundreds of years ago by Isaiah. What's my point? Well, my point is that what John did wasn't random. It's something that was part of a much bigger divine plan. Part of what God had planned for the world. I always try and succeed, hopefully, to remind us that we should never read bits of scripture in isolation. It's one massive big book and it's all together for a reason. We may struggle to see it as one whole piece of divine writing at times, but it is, and we should never ever forget that. So going back to John the Baptist, excuse me, he was part of what God had planned for the world. Not just sending Jesus as Messiah, but calling and sending John as the messenger. God is not random. He's planned. He's well thought out. He doesn't make mistakes, even though we might think he makes some odd choices. He doesn't make mistakes. Israel knew of the promise of a Messiah, and they'd been waiting for him for a very, very long time. John fulfilled his part He did what he was called to do by God. He proclaimed the coming of the Messiah. He didn't proclaim his own power or his own importance. He made sure that he pointed straight to the Messiah, to the way that was about to come. And I think that's a sobering thing to remember. We're all called to serve God. We're all called to point straight to him. If whatever we do points to us and how good we are, we're in serious trouble. I've met a few leaders and Christians who seem to be so full of their own self-importance, and it felt that it was about them and not about God. Please, if it ever feels to any of you that when I do things like this, it's about me and not about God, then, you know, please feel free to send me an email, a tweet rather. Come round, give me a swift kick, obviously at social distancing. But please, I'd need to know. We need to be good and faithful servants of the Almighty. It's all about him. It always is. John preached and baptised people. He baptised with water, but he pointed towards the one who would baptise with the Holy Spirit. This next bloke is different. His baptism came from somewhere else, apart from one of Earth's elements. What's coming as greater and bigger. The prophecy will be fulfilled. I'm only the messenger. That's what John was saying. And the man that John talked about, the Messiah, came to be baptised by him. Can you imagine what that was like? The only way I could think about it was if, I suppose, the Archbishop of Canterbury knocked on the door at 5 to 10 and said, "Can I come to your service?" Well, obviously I wouldn't let him in because it's of social distancing. But to have somebody kind of that amazing, or the Queen knock on the door and say, "I'd like to hear you." It must have been breathtaking for John to see Jesus in front of him. And what did John see? Heaven being torn apart and the Spirit of God descending. You know, it wouldn't have been like looking at the sky and a little window opens and this dove gets shoved out and makes a bit of a flutter. It would have been like seeing the divine in reality. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. It's a concept that I find hard to get a real grasp of. Do I believe it happens? Yes, of course I do. Does it make my head hurt sometimes? Yes, of course it does. As you know, if you know me at all, I always like to give you something to mull over, to take home with you, except that you're all actually at home. So something to take into the kitchen as you make your next cup of coffee, maybe. I want you to think about putting your own name at the end of verse 11. My dad, who's just sat here, called Jim. Jim is my son, whom I love. With Jim, I am well pleased. Now, please don't get hung up on the son bit if you're a girlie, because daughters inherited nothing in those days. It was all about being the son. To be thought of as a son was a highly elevated place. A sought out place to be. It was an honour. And it was an honour to be an heir. Why would I get you to do this? To replace Jesus' name with yours? Remember, Jesus replaced us on the cross so that we could be in that very place with God. To have a relationship with God again. A relationship that was broken in Eden. I ask you to do this to remind you how precious you are to God. Jesus was baptised with water and then anointed by God. That's what Messiah means, anointed one. And then his ministry began on earth. When God asks us to do things, it's not in our own power. He anoints us to do what he calls us to do. Although Israel had been waiting for the Messiah for years, he was something else altogether. He was altogether different, altogether new. He was a teacher, not like the ones that they knew. He was a different kind of teacher. He was a bloke who spoke with real authority, not like anybody that they knew. There was something altogether different about this teacher. Jesus had his Father's authority. Jesus spoke with his Father's power. And you know what? So can each one of you. Each and every person watching this now. We can speak with God's authority. We're called in God's name. We're sent out in God's name. We work in God's name, in his authority. When we talk about God and we share the gospel, we're not doing it on our own. When we're called to do something for God, he gives us that authority to do it. We need to remember that. We need to remember that it is God that we are working for. What's coming in your future that you find scary? Pretty much everything, it feels like sometimes. Do you feel scared? Yeah, you probably do, a bit or quite a lot. Does it feel a little bit like jumping off a cliff sometimes? The difference is that we have God to hold our hands when we jump off that cliff. That makes it scary and safe, all rolled into one. In whose authority do we work? God's. The authority comes from God, and we work in it. Too many times I've heard Christian preachers and teachers talk about God, and it sounds about as exciting as going to watch the tide come in Western Supermare. Jesus wasn't a wimp, and neither are we. We're not God or Jesus, we know that. But we need to remember who it is that asks us to do the things that he equips us to do. We do things in God's authority, and he gives us the power to complete the task. Two verses that I didn't read because it wasn't really part of today's reading. Jesus took himself off to be alone. He stopped for a while. You can't go through life saying we don't have to slow down. We don't have to spend a short time with God. We do, especially now. If you drove your car around all day and you never had time to put petrol in it, you'd soon come to a full stop, wouldn't you? You need gas in your tank. We need time to spend with God so he can restore us. If Jesus needed to do it, then who are we to say that we don't? And next we need to do, we need to do it even more, I think, in this year. Especially now. Remember those words. And a voice came from heaven. You are my son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased. And I'm going to say that again. I'm going to leave a space, and you are going to put your own name in there, okay? And a voice came from heaven saying to everyone who was watching, are my sons, whom I love, with I am well pleased. God will give you all that you need. You're not alone. Wherever you are, you're not alone. You are never, ever alone. As Jesus said, and surely I will be with you always to the very end of the age. Amen. Amen. Recently, when we've been in church, we've listened to some music at the end of the sermon, and we're going to do exactly the same today. So I just want to encourage you just to sit back, to listen to the words, and to, I suppose, breathe in the spirit that is around you. Watching on Twitter, I've got no idea how much of this service you've actually seen because I think my camera stopped. We're recording again, so you might be watching two different bits of a service, but what I can promise you is I'll put it on YouTube as soon as I'm finished and you'll get to see the whole thing. What I'd like to do now is to say the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
Amen. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, as we come this morning, we pray for your spirit of peace upon this world. Father, we pray for all that's gone on in the US here this week. We grieve for those people who've died. We pray for those people who've been so scared. We pray for the divisions in that country. Father, we pray that you will heal those divisions. Father, bring your joy and your light back into such dark times. Father, return love into people's heart and not hatred. Father, we pray that your will be done. And that's what people will strive for. Your will, not their will and their wants. And Father, we pray that for the rest of the world too. As we continue to battle coronavirus in a war that sometimes seems like it's winning, we pray for calm on this earth. We pray for your peace that passes all understanding to be in each person's heart. And Father, we ask that when we ask ourselves questions, we can say those words, what can I do for you? What can I do for my neighbour? Not what do I want? Heavenly Father, make our hearts about serving you and not ourselves. Father, we know it's about you. It's always about you. And Father, for each individual one of us, we pray that you can restore us. Life is different, life is hard. But Father, help us to look for the joy in this world. Help us to look for you. Help us to look at what we can do for you and make this world a better place. One act of random kindness at a time. And gathering our prayers and praises into one, as our Saviour has taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen.
And let's say the grace together, if you know the words. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us always. Amen. Amen. As we close, we're going to listen to a fantastic song called Greatest Day in History, or Happy Day, whichever. But as we listen to it, let's be reminded that we still have that greatest day in history to celebrate each and every day. And if you feel like having a dance, wherever you are, in your slippers and your pyjamas or whatever you've got on, dance for God and remember the joy. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.